Good morning. To those who are on site and for those who are online, I bid you well. I hope that you are with me in this journey of reading Isaiah. As many have pointed out, it's not an easy book to read. I remember doing a Hebrew exegesis paper on Isaiah 9, and oh my, it was torturous. I told my lecturer that it was a painful paper to write, to which my lecturer replied, "No pain, no gain. Glad you gain." I'll talk about pain. About a year ago, our brother Marcus, or many of you know him as Sichiao, was battling cancer, stage 4 lymphoma. We have heard his story during church anniversary this year. I remember it was a very painful period for him. And at the start of his chemotherapy, he sent a video to his prayer support group. And he gave a rallying cry. "Pain is tempura! Glory is forever!" Yes, you have heard it, right? He said, "Tempura." A few of us in the chat group was pretty sure we heard tempura. What he meant was, pain is temporal, glory is forever. And so there remains a long-standing joke that we'll have a tempura feast to celebrate if he gets well. And as we know, he got well, and it's almost a year now, and we still haven't gotten down to it. In this case, tempura is forever. Now, jokes aside, the phrase, "pain is tempura, glory is forever," is stuck in my head ever since, and even as I was preparing for this sermon. And that is why I entitled this sermon, "Suffering is Tempura." I found out from Sichiao that this phrase was commonly used by the commandos in his army days to give motivation to the troops. And in our journey through Isaiah, we find Prophet Isaiah giving the same rallying cry, comfort and encouragement for Israel, reminding them that their suffering is temporal, but his glory is forever. Now, last week, Preacher Wendy recapped for us what we've been going through in Isaiah, and may I add that if we were to zoom out from the book of Isaiah, we see two distinct portions that is dissected very similarly to the Bible. You see, the front portion consists of 39 chapters, and in the back, 27 chapters, very much like the Old Testament and New Testament. And that's why people call Isaiah the miniature Bible. The front portion of Isaiah focuses on judgment because of Israel's disobedience. And the second portion emphasizes on forgiveness and restoration. In the latter half, Isaiah seeks to rally and bring comfort to Israel through four passages, or what is known as the four servant songs. All right, and these four songs are about God's hope for Israel and the universal salvation through God's servant. Today, let us zoom into the fourth servant song in Isaiah 53, which is at the very heart of Isaiah and the entire Bible. So much so that scholars have touted the fourth servant song as the gospel according to Isaiah. Well, this song actually begins in Isaiah 52, verse 13, and the entire Isaiah 53. But to keep it simple, whenever I refer to Isaiah 53, it refers to the entire servant song, including the last three verses of Isaiah 52. Okay? All right. Now, in this servant song, there are five distinct stanzas for us to zero in. So let me read them for you. "See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted, just as there were many who were appalled at him. His appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any human being, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So he will sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For they were not told, they will see. For what they have not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He has no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom people hide their faces. He was despised and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgression. He was crushed for our iniquities. Punishment that brought us peace was on him. And by his wounds, we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us have turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Though he has done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord make his life an offering for sin, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After he has suffered, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Come, let us pray. O Lord, prepare our hearts as we receive your word as spoken through the prophet Isaiah. I pray that even as we dwell under the light of your word, we may see light, and in your truth find freedom, and in your will discover your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So today, what I set out to do is to answer two simple yet important questions. We'll explore together who this suffering servant is and what is the message of the servant song for us today. Well, you might be thinking the first question, very easy, what? Well, if you are thinking what I'm thinking, then this person must be someone who had been raised by a carpenter. And the carpenter is not his biological father. He was born by a miracle and was no ordinary being. He was created with innate knowledge. He sacrificed his life to save others, was resurrected with a new body. And this person is Pinocchio. I was describing Pinocchio. You see, it would be too quick to assume until we are convinced that this is Jesus I'm talking about. And for the first readers, it would have not been so obvious to them. After all, this was written 700 years before Jesus. Even the Ethiopian eunuch, while reading Isaiah 53, was asking Philip if Isaiah was talking about himself or someone else. In fact, modern Jewish rabbinic interpretation of the same passage regards the servant in the passage to be Israel. This is because if we were to look back into the three servant songs and prior, we will find that the subject of those passages are repeatedly identified as the nation of Israel. And so we have to think in the shoes of Israel and not despise the question on the identity of this suffering servant, but rather, let me take some time to establish his identity. Now, there are a few key things we need to know about this servant from this passage. From the outset, we find that this servant was not what people expected. In fact, he was shocking in two ways. One is his appearance that would be so disfigured that he does not look like a human. Second is that this servant will have shockingly great impact on nations and the world. Now, this servant is not good looking to start with. Definitely not the kind that would draw many followers on Instagram. No. And instead of a strong and flourishing oak tree, all that was described of this servant was a stump, a tender shoot, a sapling, which tells us that it is weak. And gardeners usually snip off such roots as soon as they appear because they'll be fighting for nutrients with the main plant. And so this servant was not just weak, but very vulnerable. Then we are told that he was in pain and suffering. He was afflicted, pierced, crushed, and all the iniquities were laid on him. He was a man of sorrows. And not just that, he was a silent scapegoat who made no protest against the ones who's killing him. and they laid him among the wicked and the rich. Now, against these descriptions, I'm convinced that Isaiah was prophesying about the person of Jesus. Why? Because, number one, the descriptions fit like a glove. If you were to check thoroughly, every single prophecy is fulfilled in the person of Jesus. There is no one else in history that fits this description, and the probability of doing so is next to zero. So for me, it's either Jesus or nobody. Number two, Pinocchio was written by a Christian author. He drew his inspiration from the gospel. So the similarity in description was purely fabricated. Number three, there is a shift in how Isaiah addressed this servant from the other servant songs. From a nation or a group of people, Isaiah 53 describes an individual in singular form. Number four, the Talmud, which is a Jewish commentary of the Hebrew Bible, it never did establish that Israel is a servant of in Isaiah 53. The suggestion for it to be Israel is a modern interpretation. And if I were to believe in something, I would choose to believe in commentaries that were closer to source in time or space. Number five, there are approximately 80 references in the New Testament, and most of them allude Jesus to be this suffering servant. And most compelling of all is the declaration by Jesus himself in Luke's account, where he quoted Isaiah 53 and said that this must be fulfilled in me. What is written about me is reaching its fulfillment. Now, don't believe everything I say. Go and check it for yourself. And that leaves us with the second half of this sermon. What then is the message of the servant song for our lives today? I won't dwell too much on the soteriological aspect of Isaiah 53, which means the mechanism of salvation to which Christ died for our sins as atonement, etc., which we are very familiar with, but I'm going to zoom in on the topic of suffering. Now you see, Israel is suffering, and they know what had happened and what is going to happen, but they do not know why it happened. They do not know why it happened. Is it because of our sin? Is it retributive suffering? Or is it innocent suffering like Job? I don't know what's going on, but I just suffer. Or is it educative? God is trying to teach me something. They know the what, but they do not know the why. And humans have this insatiable need to know the whys in life. And there's nothing wrong in wanting to know the why. Because knowing why sometimes helps us to explain the suffering we go through, and our inconveniences are immediately deprioritized. There was one day when I was in TTC, and I was driving down Clementi Road to the school, and there was an all-important OT1 exam. All very fearful of this exam, because it's very important. And then there was a big jam, and there my heart was racing and pounding because, I don't want to be late for the exam. Come on, move it! And after inching forward for some time, I came to the epicenter of the jam. There had been an accident involving a car and a motorcyclist. And when I saw a motionless body lying on the ground, everything else just fades away. OT exam doesn't matter anymore. My inconvenience is deprioritized. All I want is for that man to be okay. My point is this. Sometimes, facts can obscure the truth, like a jigsaw puzzle. Each piece of fact cannot give us the whole picture. And the truth is that big picture. The fact is, yes, there was a jam, but the complete fact is that there was a jam because there had been an accident. And the bigger and more important picture is not about the jam, but a life hanging on its balance. To begin understanding the message behind Isaiah 53, we need to differentiate what is fact and what is truth. And a large part of the truth can be found in the final stanza in Isaiah 53. We see the opening lines of Isaiah 53:10. They are terrible. Well, the fact is God willed it to happen. So what kind of good father would wish this for his son to be crushed? It is only possible if there are some unquestionably good, greater good to be obtained.
And what greater good could possibly justify the crushing of the servant?
The answer is given in the second half of this verse.
It is when the life of the servant is offered as a sin offering that God's purpose in bringing him to this place is realized through the word prosper. Then will the injustice of being deprived as children and a long life be rectified. The righteous servant will justify many. The servant did not come to tell people what God wants. Rather, he came to be what God wants for us. Another image of truth is suggested by verse 11. We are told that after the suffering of his entire being, he will see and be satisfied. And although the word translated as suffering is not typically used of birth pangs, but it connotes something, the idea of misery. But there is still a parallel to the act of giving birth. Now you see, pregnancy is not an easy thing at all. A mother has to carry the child for a night of close to 40 weeks. And remember when Gracia was carrying, there was morning sickness, baby pressing against the bladder, so constant urination during the night is inevitable. It was heavy, it was uncomfortable, the feet get swollen, and at the same time, we were worrying about 1,001 things. Gestational diabetes, there was this bacterium called the GBS, group B strep, that was in Inez when she was about to be born. And on the day of delivery itself, we had to prepare our bags, and on the day of delivery itself, the water bag broke in the car. Well, the baby had meconium, which means that the baby pooped inside the sack. And the baby needs to be out real quick. And so we reached the hospital, and Gracia was only 1 cm dilated. We were thinking, oh no, she needs to be out soon. But in the span of 2 hours, 1 cm dilation went on to 9 cm very quickly. I think the epidural haven't even kicked in. So pain and struggle was written all over her face and her body. She was holding on to the side of the bed and she was like struggling, laughing gas, everything in, but still struggling. Finally, there was a great moment when Inez was born. I was shocked. It wasn't the prettiest thing to observe ever. The baby was red, wrinkled, and weird looking. Nothing like what I see on TV. I was so shocked that my guy said, hey, take picture leh. I said, oh, okay, take picture. But when the nurse laid her on Gracia, I watched in wonder, as though all the pain and struggle washed out of her face and she beamed with love. Go through the whole process again? Maybe not. Worth it? Definitely yes. And that's how it is with Jesus. He sees the newborn Christian and is satisfied. He considers all that it costs him to redeem us as not so much. So the fact is that God willed for his son to suffer and be crushed. But the truth is that God willed it for a greater good. The truth is that Jesus will prosper, his days will be prolonged, and he will see the light of life and be satisfied. Because he has justified many, and he will do it again and again for you, because you are worth it. Now, the second thing is this. The fact is that the arm of God looks scrawny and weak and not the kind of Messiah we would expect. In 53 verse 1, it says, who has believed our message and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Remember in one of the sermons I preached, I told you that the arm of God is usually paired with connotations of his might and his power. All right, but in this usage here in Isaiah 53, it was nothing like that. We are told this time that the arm of the Lord looks weak and vulnerable. It's as though God rolled up his sleeve to bear and flex his F-45 arms, but to the disappointment of many, the bicep looked like a mouse. Who would believe the message that this Jesus will be alleviating our suffering? The fact is, no one will believe because Jesus did not look the part of a Messiah. We all know that the hand or the arm of God is an important imagery in the Bible. But more than just denoting his power and might, it is a metaphor of God's involvement in humanity's salvation throughout history. The hand of God represents an assuring love that will never leave us nor forsake us. It represents the sovereignty of God. And the salvific arms of His that stretches through generations is throughout the Bible itself. And Jesus understood this. And when we understand the sovereignty of God, we will begin to realize that the testing of our lives, the rejection, the humiliation, the suffering is for a greater and grander purpose. Israel was also rejected by many, and the encouragement to Israel is that mockery will not be the final word. There was once a young Christian who received and read the Bible for the first time, and after finishing up the Bible, he ran into his pastor's office and said, "I read to the end of the book. In the end, we win." Rejection will not be the final word. Injustice will not be the final word. Disparity will not be the final word. Sin and death will not be the final word. The weak will be made strong, and in the end, we win. Maybe you too were mocked by others, either for your intellect, social status, or class, or even how you look. Maybe you have tried to share the gospel with others and faced rejection time and time again. Or maybe you have tried to choose integrity at work, but that will mean losing favor with your boss. In life, we Christians often look to be people who are easily bullied or exploited, easy to bully or exploit. People take advantage of our kindness. We bear the burden of online mocking of the church in the comment section of Christian articles, and we feel indignant. Know that at the end of the day, we win. So the fact is this, we will look like we are weak and rejected and mocked at. We seem to inherit God's scrawny arms. But the truth is that the arm was not to show His might, but His sovereignty. And we know the ending to our struggle. In the end, we win. Then what about physical suffering like cancer or COVID? I paraphrase a third article by Pastor Rick. The fact is, yes, Isaiah 53 tells us, by His wounds, by His stripes, we are healed. In both physical and spiritual sense, we can tell this in Jesus' healing ministry. There is physical healing available, and that is a fulfillment to Isaiah 53. But what about those who do not get healed? The truth is, Isaiah 53:5 is only fulfilled in part for now. The healing ministry of Jesus on earth was just a glimpse of what is to come. The fullness of Isaiah 53:5 will only be experienced when the triumphant Christ returns for His bride, the church. The removal of sin, evil, suffering in this world will only take place at the second coming of Christ. And on that day, Revelation tells us that there will be a new heaven and new earth. There will be no more death, no or mourning or crying or pain, for the old has passed away. In other words, sickness, diseases, physical death will only be fully abolished on that day, not now. We must be reminded that Jesus promises His believers not the absence of suffering on earth, but the peace in the midst of it all. To add, God promises us that there will be joy, hope, purpose in our suffering, endurance and deliverance, and that He will cause every affliction we face on earth to serve for glory tomorrow. You see, my friends, we are not just saved from something, but we are also saved to something. This world is not the end of God's story for humanity, and we will continue to live in this tension temporarily until the day comes where we are brought to glory. And we call this tension the already but not yet. No, Christ has done the work, we have gained the victory, but the complete consummation will only happen later on. An example of this would be during World War II on D-Day, 6th of June 1944 at the Normandy beach. The Allied forces secured a victory beyond doubt. And through that victory itself, it is as good as the war is won. That is on D-Day. But the war is not officially over until 8th of May 1945, which is known as the Victory Day. So between now and then, there is still sporadic fighting, there is still sporadic struggling and suffering. until it is finally over on V-Day. In our current times, it's like the government say our strategy is to go endemic, but not yet. We know that the day will come where we will be free again, but until we reach that day, we have to grapple with restrictions, confusion, high cases and deaths. But we know that that is only temporal. So the fact is this, that we will still experience suffering in this world because we live in a broken world. We know that. But the truth is that this suffering is temporal and glory is forever. Having said that all, it reminded me of a time when I was suffering in the army. But just in case you think it is another story of, you know, guys going through army and then suffering, it is not. You see, I'm the kind of guy who like to chiong. I'm the no guts, no glory, no pain, no gain kind of guy. You ask me to charge up the hill, I will charge up the hill. You ask me run 20 km, I'll run 40 km. That kind, you know, where people call xiao on. Okay, so there was that kind of expectations on other people, my friends, on me, and myself, that I will be an army officer in the SAF. In fact, I would have signed on to the army if not for my torn ligament, which I suffered during rugby in my JC days. And alas, I was deemed as unfit by the SAF. I was given the PES status of C2L2, which simply means that I was excused from any activity that involves the lower limbs. Right? So I was devastated. I felt like I was branded as a low-grade reject shop sweatshirt. I remember there was this one time during BMT when my platoon was running around the track. And you know, in Tekong, there was a main track, and there were many companies that surrounds that one track. And I tell you, my platoon, right, was full of very fit people. National hurdlers, soccer players, ruggers, all with the PES status of C2L2. Because although they are medically unfit, they are not physically unfit. And so we ran. We ran around the track, and we started singing army songs. Wow, very garang, right? And then I heard from a distance, laughter. You see, the guys from other companies were mocking and laughing at us. This bunch of weaklings trying to act garang. That day was a new low for me. I finally understood the line which says, I hear a mocking voice call out among the scoffers. I felt humiliated, I felt rejected. And so the group of us in my platoon, we appealed to our officer to arrange for the medical officer to upgrade, to reassess and upgrade our PES status. To which that officer promised, but never fulfilled. And so we were humiliated, rejected, and even betrayed. Even when we passed out of BMT, there wasn't even a ceremonial parade to celebrate the end of BMT. We were just told to pack out our bags, take a ferry from Tekong, and that's it. No pride, no honor. So physically, I felt incomplete because of my leg. Emotionally, I felt unworthy. I was bruised. My ego was bruised. Spiritually, I couldn't see God in all this. And I was silently angry with him. But you know what? God redeemed me when I was in New Zealand in the month-long exercise with the army. I began to read the scripture and found healing through the truth found in the gospel. The same truth that can be found in Isaiah 53 that seeks to encourage all who are weary. Beyond the facts, I began to uncover the truth behind my suffering and found healing physically, emotionally, and spiritually. So you might think, oh, after you ORD, should be okay, right? No, not yet. Because still got reservist. A liability you have to see through after those 2 years in the army. So I was already, but not yet. So just before I ROD, which is like the end of everything, the victory ceremony, like I'm completely free from my national service duties, I went to the medical officer and request for an upgrade in PES status, which of course he granted me, because not many requests like that lah. Usually it's to downgrade. But you want to upgrade? Okay, by all means, go ahead. Which he granted me. And then I felt complete and did my first IPPT. My forever glory is restored. Now, have I gone through worse suffering in life before? Of course, there are. But what I chose this story to share with you is to let you know that there is no suffering too trivial or frivolous. It may sound very superficial, right? It's not like, you know, all the guys want your kind of PES status, you know. Why we always suffer over this kind of thing? Like, very superficial, very frivolous. But I just want to tell you that there's no suffering too trivial or frivolous. Yes, in relative to what others in the world go through, this is nothing. But when we start making that comparison, we are failing to listen to the heart of the sufferer. Try telling a student who is clinically depressed that his or her worry is unfounded in comparison to the thousands of children who can't even get education. Even that is true, we do not downplay the emotions and pain of the sufferer. Try telling the 18-year-old me that your suffering is nothing. Empathy and a listening ear are sometimes what we need. That is why the incarnational ministry of Jesus is important, because it bridges a heavenly deity to human reality. He's not a God who lives away up there, a God who didn't care, but he is a God who knows our pain. No matter how frivolous it may be, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams, broken hearts, wounded hearts, broken toys, give them all to Jesus. You may be battling with weight gain, insomnia, failing businesses, nightmarish landlords, cyberbullying, heart hurts, back pain, stigmas, loneliness, being barren, acne, loss of a loved one, COVID, betrayal, cancer. Give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams, wounded hearts, broken toys. Give them all to Jesus. Sometimes life isn't always fair. Some people have to walk on unpaved roads their entire lives, while some run at full speed only to end up at the edge of a cliff. But what I learned from Isaiah is that life is not the end. There's a glorious after tomorrow waiting for us beyond the horizon. Sometimes life is like running through the tunnel. It is dark and we only see a little light. And I like what Henry Nouwen says, when he says that when we are able to take the next step with trust, that we will have enough light for the step that follows, we can walk through life with joy and be surprised at how far we go. Let's rejoice in the little light that we carry and not ask for the great beam that takes all shadows away. Sometimes the rain can make us feel sticky and uncomfortable. But what I learned from a certain Korean drama is just to put your hands up and learn to cha-cha in the rain. Sometimes the rain carries a grander purpose. Sometimes we feel like we are struggling and drowning in the waters. What I learned from Isaiah is that there is a floating piece of wood for us to hang on to, a piece of wood that our master carpenter crafted in form of the cross. The cross is a place where suffering and glory meet. I don't know what you're going through, but for all who are going through who are in the thick of suffering and pain of any kind right now, I have something for you. Tell you, we will march on, we shall overcome with Christ, our living hope. And may the words of the prophet Isaiah, especially in chapter 53, always remind us that suffering is tempura. Glory is forever. Amen.